Well, take your Bibles tonight and turn to the book of Philippians. Philippians chapter 2. As most of you are aware of, over the last 12 to 14 weeks, we have been studying the 10 declarations of God, better known as the 10 commandments. We finished that a couple weeks ago with the last commandment of not coveting your neighbor's wife or his material goods or whatever. Don't covet the wrong things. And we said the opposite of that is learning to be content. And so 2 weeks ago, we started talking, as we finished up the last commandment, we also began talking about what it means to be content. And I thought to myself, you know, at least for me, that's somewhere where we just need to plant for a while. Learning how to be content. Paul says, I've learned the secret. I know. I've learned it. And that's what we need to do. Because if there's one thing that can describe the world today, and really one thing that can describe the church today sometimes, is the fact that we are a people who have not learned to be content. And so we continue that subject this evening on the principles of contentment. And we'll be here for a few weeks at least. So before we get into it, let's bow our heads and hearts in a word of prayer. You just take a moment and prepare yourself for the Word of God, the teaching of His Word. And then you pray silently there, and then we will pray together and get into the Word. Again, Father, we're thankful this evening for the opportunity we have to open up your word. And Father, as we deal with this subject of contentment, may we be a people who are obedient to the principles of your word. Father, may as we grow in our spiritual growth, as we become more like you, may that example of contentment be in our lives. We pray that you'd help us to take the principles of your word and apply them to our lives, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, 2 weeks ago, we looked at Philippians chapter 2, primarily there verses 12 and 13, which we called the sanctification principles. How we ought to be a people who are working out what God is working in. You're doing and God's doing as far as our spiritual lives are concerned. And in verse number 12, it says, so then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. The spiritual transformation that God brings into our lives at salvation needs to come out. He does not say here, work for or work at your salvation. He says here, work out your salvation, what God has been doing in your life. And then he says this in verse 13, as far as working out, for it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. And so the whole idea here is that we ought to make our lifestyle, we ought to have a pattern in our life of being Christians who are bringing forth what God has done within in the transformation work of his salvation. And realize, therefore, that we have a personal responsibility in doing this. God does a work, and then we have a responsibility to work it out, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, to be constant, consistent in our working out the spiritual sanctification that God has brought forth through salvation. And then it's interesting, the next thing he mentions is verse 14 there. And in verse 14, after saying, all right, you guys need to show forth a spiritual life, working out what God has worked in. And the first principle he mentions in verse 14 is, do all things without grumbling and disputing. James McDonald, in his book, Lord, Change My Attitude, gave a definition, and, you know, I you can still quote James McDonald. I know there's some controversy around him and stuff like that. I don't know what it all is and stuff, but he did give this definition. Complaining is expressing dissatisfaction with circumstances that is not wrong, about which I am doing nothing to correct. Expressing dissatisfaction with circumstances that are not wrong. They're just everyday life experiences somewhat that we tend to complain about and which you're doing nothing to correct. And so what Paul tells us here in verse 14 is we ought to be a people who are containing our complaining. And really, when you stop and think about it, our human nature is to be people who complain. It comes naturally. Even when you try to work on it sometimes, there are those times when complaining comes out in various ways, in various forms. But it's human nature to complain. But that's what Paul is saying. You have been transformed. So your human nature has been engrafted a spiritual nature that should, with the power of the Holy Spirit, enable you not to go around with grumbling and disputing. So tonight I want us to look at that idea of containing our complaining. What does it cost when we complain? What are the dangers that it brings when we become a group of people who do nothing but complain? I suppose, and we're going to turn back to Deuteronomy chapter 1, that there's no greater illustration of in which there is so much complaining going on than with the children of Israel. Especially during their time when they are wandering in the wilderness for those 40 years. And if you were to describe the children of Israel during those 40 years, I'm not sure if you would say where they were a spiritual bunch who loved the Lord as much as you would read and think to yourself as you read about them, this is a bunch of complainers and whiners and disgruntled people. You see it over and over again as you read through their struggles. And in Deuteronomy, Moses is dealing with the people. They're getting ready to enter the promised land. Their 40 years are up. And he just kind of reviews their history with them as such. And in verse 26, it says, you were not willing to go up, but rebelled against the commandments of the Lord your God. Remember when they first entered in the promised land, before they entered the promised land, they said, no, we can't go in there. And then the people freaked out and said, oh, this is terrible. Why'd you bring us here? You're going to allow us to die here. What are we going to do? And that's what he says. You rebelled against the commandment of the Lord your God, and you grumbled in your tents and said, because the Lord hates us, he has brought us out of the land of Egypt to deliver us into the hands of the Amorites to destroy us. Where can we go? Up. Our brothers have made our hearts melt, saying the people are bigger and stronger than we. The cities are larger and fortified to heaven. And besides, we saw the sons of Amalekin there. So as we realize the children of Israel set that example, the first thing we want to look at this evening is the cause of our complaining. The cause of our complaining. And there's three things we can look at as far as the cause of our complaining. The first one is that of rebellion. Rebellion. That's what he says there in verse 26. Not willing to go up, but rebelled against the commandments of the Lord. They were disobedient. They were not willing to do what God wants them to do. Most of you know the story, the Israelites going into the promised land. They get the report from the 12 spies. Is that correct? Yeah, I always get like 10 or 12. There were 10 bad and 2 were good. 12 spies. The 10 came back and they said, there's no way we can do this. And then they start complaining and complaining. The people finally say, we can't do this. This is horrible. This is bad. And God says, okay, you want to rebel? I'll show you bad. 40 years wandering in the wilderness because of their rebellion. A lot of times we want to rebel against the things that God has told us to do or the things that God allowed into our lives. We must be careful about that. Verse 26, again, you were not willing to go up, but rebelled. You need to be obedient to what God tells us to do. They were disobedient. Second of all, a cause for complaining is that of reaction. Reaction. Reactions to tough circumstances. Thought about this. I've had a bad week this week. Bad week. Not complaining, I'm just informing. Because I said, you know, I'm driving down the road this week, got in front of Kermit's, well, I should say the Worley's house down there now, but Kermit Williams' house. New tire, blows out. I was able to get it to the garage at the house and had to jack that thing up. And, you know, the way they make jacks for cars now, I was hot. How was I going to react? Brand new tire. Had a root canal this week. First one in my life. I'm on drugs right now. No. But anyway, that's my problem. Not fun. Not fun. I told them when they called me Wednesday evening, tell me I was going to do that on Thursday. I said, I got to tell you right now, my teeth do not hurt. When I leave your office, I do not want my teeth to hurt. I went to their office. They didn't keep their bargain. Although it didn't hurt when he did it, but anyway. Out golfing. Pouring down rain. But you know, as I stopped and thought, I'm thankful I have a car that I can get around. How am I going to react to these things? I'm thankful that although a month ago my dentist told me you're going to need a root canal, I said, well, I don't hurt. I don't need a root canal until about 2 weeks ago. And then I told Cheryl, I said, I feel it coming. But I'm glad we have people to take care of those things. And even in the midst of rain showers when you're golfing, I'm thankful for the men that we were able to fellowship with and the time that we were able to spend together. How are we going to react to the things that happen in our life? Bad things will happen. Difficult circumstances will take place. And a lot of times, I know I do, and I imagine most of you do, we forget that God's in control of all this. God did not set up in heaven this week and say, huh, Kenny had a flat tire. I wasn't expecting that. Huh, Kenny has a bad tooth. What a surprise. And then the Lord didn't set up in heaven and say, you know, when we started the scramble yesterday, that guy who was in charge of the golf course told us it would not rain till 1 o'clock. And God set up in heaven and said, it's only 10:30. It's raining. How did that happen? God was not taken out of by surprise by anything that happened in our lives. He's in control. And although it takes work, spiritual work, not to react in the wrong way when those circumstances happen the way they do. So our reaction causes us to complain sometimes. And then lastly, just rejection of the truth. Rejection. In Deuteronomy chapter 1 and verse 32, it says this, "But for all this, you did not trust the Lord your God." Unbelief. Look at chapter 2 of Deuteronomy in verse 7. Here's the problem. They rejected trusting God, and he tells them in verse 7 of chapter 2, "For the Lord your God has blessed you all that you have done. He has known your wandering through this great wilderness. These 40 years the Lord your God has been with you. You have not lacked a thing." I've underlined in my Bible, blessed, known, not lacked a thing. And when we stop and we think about all that God has done for us over the years, how faithful he has been, even in the midst of our... I stand amazed, and we're on Wednesday night are going through a study of overcoming fear and worry and that sort of thing, and I stand amazed how God has been so faithful even through this past year and a half with all that we've gone through as far as this virus is concerned, as far as our government is concerned. I have to say to myself, we are still blessed. He knows exactly what's going on, and we have not lacked a thing. And the rebuke that Moses gives to the Israelites is the fact that they were now not trusting God, as he says there in verse 32, "You did not trust the Lord your God." But let me remind you, you rejected the truth of knowing that God blessed you, he knows everything, and you have lacked nothing. And although we may not have everything we want, we've lacked nothing. What do we have to complain about? We should be a contented people because of the knowledge of who our God is and all that he does. So the cause of complaining, rebellion, reaction, and rejection. The curse of complaining. The curse of complaining. Chapter 1 of Deuteronomy in verse 27 says, "And you grumbled in your tents." But let me ask you something. Is that as far as the grumbling went? And if you know anything about the children of Israel, and they're wandering in the wilderness, it did not stay in the tents. Grumbling and complaining is contagious. It is contagious. It might begin in the tent, but pretty soon, and you can read the book of Deuteronomy, primarily the book of Numbers, and you can see, I mean, anybody in any type of leadership will hear all sorts of complaining. Can you imagine the complaining that Moses heard with this very large group of people that he was leading? And he's doing everything he can do to get these people to the promised land, and they're doing nothing but complaining and complaining and complaining because it is contagious. We must be very, very careful of that. Not only is it contagious, but but it is contentious. It's contentious. In other words, in the midst of all the complaining, if we're not careful, it can cause all kinds of division and disputings. I dare say, and I've never been a part of one, and I trust God I never will be a part of one, but only by the grace of God, but I dare say that most church splits are caused primarily by complaining that become out of hand. In fact, I have heard of and seen church splits that are not splitting because of doctrinal issues, but mainly because of disgruntled people who are going around complaining about various things. I think if you're in a church that is unsound biblically and teaching false doctrines, then yes, we have a problem there. And you must be careful about that. If that's what we see as far as these people are concerned, just a lot of disputing, a lot of division, because it comes down to the fact that the curse of complaining is very costly. Very costly. It's costly because it gets you discouraged. You can become discouraged. And your whole attitude and your whole demeanor changes. I've often said that church people ought to be Chick-fil-A people. Now, here's what I mean. No slam on other people, but it's a lot of times you go to these fast food places and their attitude with many of their employees, except for Burger King when it comes to Ezra, is very, I don't want to be here. I don't want to work here. What do you want? When you go to Chick-fil-A, those people are kind, thank you very much, my pleasure. Just pleasant to be around. And that's what happens to people who complain. They're discouraged, and they bring forth a disposition, an attitude that, who wants to be around that? And so they become discouraged, and we become defeated. That's what happened to these people. They became discouraged. Why'd you bring us out here? Most people who complain all the time are people who just want a pity party for themselves. And so they become discouraged, disgruntled. They become defeated. That's what we see with the children of Israel. And really what happens is, in the midst of all that, the curse is that, and the cost is that we miss out on God's blessings that he wants to bestow upon us. And that's what we see as far as the children of Israel are concerned. So let's bring up the last point, lest you complain that I'm going too long. The curse of complaining. The curse of complaining. Though we'll have some complaints. There'll be people that it's just part of it. I read a thing there that said, I read somewhere where it says, God created the earth in 6 days, rested on the seventh day, and people complained on the eighth day. I also read where there was a monk who took a vow of silence and was only allowed to say 2 words per year. And it came time for him to say his 2 words, and his 2 words for the first year was bad food. That's all he allowed to say for a year. The next year came along, and his 2 words were hard bed. Those were his 2 words for that year. came to his third year and he got to say two words. And he said, "I quit." And the guy who was in charge of this monastery looked at him and said, "Well, I'm not surprised. You've done nothing but complain since you got here." That's our nature, to complain. We live in an imperfect world. Trials will happen. I often tell people, this is not heaven, this is not utopia. This is not it. There is going to become a day. Can you imagine this? There's going to come a day when you won't even have anything to complain about. But that's not now. Difficult situations, difficult circumstances will come our way. And how are we handle them? How do we keep from being enslaved to a negative spirit and attitude? Well, first of all, observation. Observation. Think back of what God has done for you. Think back at how God has been so faithful to you. Ask yourself the question, why am I complaining? What is it I'm keeping my eyes on here? That's what he says to these folks. They didn't trust God. They didn't have their eyes on him. Second of all, be opportunistic. Look for ways to become part of the solution rather than the problem. Yes, we live in an imperfect world. You can write this in your note, but I will mention it because some of you may not know it. You go to an imperfect church. So circumstances won't always be great. But you got to ask yourself, am I adding to the problem or am I seeking a solution to the problem? Have you ever noticed that many times those who do the most complaining the loudest are those who do the least? Now, that doesn't mean you can't make suggestions. And I've had people come up to me, and that's good. They come up to me and say, "Well, I think we ought to." And I say, "Have at it." "Well, I don't want to do it. I just think you are." "No, have at it. Get busy." And I thank the Lord has been so good to us here at Fayetteville. More than, I look back and I just think, wow. God has been so good in so many ways, but one of the ways he has is people who are willing to serve. And we're so fortunate in that. And then, for literary sake, I really don't know if I like the word or not, but be optimistic. Be optimistic. That doesn't mean everything's wonderful and everything's peachy and, no, there are struggles. But the idea behind that is the fact that we ought to just take time to learn to count our blessings. We sing that song, "Count Your Blessings, Name Them One by One." Our pastor in Miami, when we used to sing that song, would always say, we got to change the word. It's not count them one by one. That's count them ton by ton. We had to change the words. So we sang it, "Count Your Blessings, Name Them Ton by Ton." But God is faithful to us. And I look around our country and I am concerned. And there are a few things that I can do that might change part of that. Most of it is out of my control, totally out of my control. But I'm thankful to live in the United States of America. Many of you and myself have traveled to countries, and I am always thankful to come back to this country. I don't know what I can say. I don't know if I'll be able to say that 10, 20 years from now, but I can now. God has blessed us. to allow us to live here. God has blessed us with many things that we don't take time to count our blessings. We can always, 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 no matter what our circumstances are, no matter what the situation is, we can always rejoice in the Lord. So as you are working out your salvation, Paul tells us back in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 14, now do all things without grumbling or disputing. Our spiritual, you know, as I mentioned, our spiritual life should be like Connor's golfing life. And he's improved a lot. I don't want to golf with him. He's too good. No. But he's improved a lot. That's the way it should be with our spiritual lives. That the closer we get in the Word, the more we know God, the more God is working in us, it should come out that we learn not to complain so much. That's spiritual growth. That's progressive sanctification of becoming more like Christ. I preach to myself first. Haven't arrived, but I'm striving. And I just look forward to that day. I had someone, Rigo Garcia, called me this afternoon, a friend of mine from Miami, because Indianapolis whipped on the Dolphins today. And anytime Indianapolis loses, I call him. Anytime Miami loses, he has to call me and congratulate. He was telling me today, I'm going to come visit you at the end of December. I said, well, super. That's good. He's retired now. We both came to Miami at the same time. He's retired and lives in Georgia now. I asked him if he was a Falcon fan. He goes, I will die a Dolphin fan. I said, well, you might die a lot sooner than you think if you have to follow that team. But anyway, I'm a Colts fan. But anyway, he said to me, I said, so when you come? And he said, well, the end of December. And I said, well, super. And he says, well, I can't make anything definite. You don't know what's going to happen between now and December. And I said, I know. And he goes, the rapture might happen. I said, okay, you can still come visit. I won't be here, but I'll leave the door unlocked for you. He says, no, if the rapture happens, I'm going too. And I said, okay. But anyway, when that rapture happens, when God takes us to go to be with him, that's a glorious day. And the fact that there will be nothing to complain about again. And all we do is worship the Lord for the great God that he is. Well, let's pray. Father, again, we thank you for the opportunity we have to study your word. And as you inspired Paul to write this epistle to the church at Philippi, and he gave instructions to the church at Philippi that they're to do all things without grumblings and disputings, without complaining, you inspired him to write to the Fayetteville Baptist Church as well. That should be our attitude. So help us to work out our salvation as seen in being a contented people. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. As we close, let's sing, Rejoice in the Lord. God never moves without purpose or plan. Let's stand together and sing this in closing.